Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Wild Earth this morning. My name's Tara. Joining me on camera this morning is Herman, and back in front of control is Patrick. And I'm really eager to see if those lions are around and maybe what's happened with Karula, with those lions being in the area. She was last seen in the west. She may have moved towards Zimbambili again, rather than heading down towards Little Gowrie on the southern side of our boundary. So let's head down that way and see what we can go and find this morning. And the call of the woodland kingfisher behind us.
Morning, Melissa.
Morning, Tex. I'm saying good morning to you too.
Yeah, morning, Tara. We saw those chickens.
I'm taking quarantine west at the moment, heading down towards Philemon's Cut line, I think. pick up any sign of the Lions. I think Texan's going to try. Oh, elephant. Lutu Mangwe just got one and love here on the southwestern side of quarantine area. I've just found one in glove. See you later.
Thank you.
of dust on the road now. Give himself a dust bath. I think he actually got something up his nose. He seems to be quite relaxed. Maybe about 25, something like that. Very old bull. And he has been eating a lot of Maruna fruit. Done at the moment. And it is normal to find bull elephants on their own like this. Sometimes may decide they just want their alone time. Sometimes they may decide that they do want company of other bulls. And sometimes you'll find the bulls with the females, if there's a female. Finds the females. And join them. What would be beautiful is if we can get the sunrise behind them. See if we can a little bit further ahead maybe. Gone too far. See, he's got his trunk up. I think he's smelling where the other Maruna fruits are. Maybe all the trees have been stripped bare of the fruits on the southern side. Let's see if he's going to stop at that one. Can we maybe catch the sun? It's looking beautiful. Good morning from Africa to everybody across the world. I think I'm hearing alarm calling. Okay, we're going to leave this bull elephant. So I'm hearing the alarm calling of the impala we've just seen.
Not. On the eastern side of the camp, that is probably free. It was my job.
Okay, they're all looking to the west. Might be worth just trying that little two track down that side. They're still looking that way. The impala in front haven't picked up the warning. What did you see, guys? Well, there's one or two still looking down this way, and I did hear quite a few. At first I thought it was a male upsetting everybody. But the others could have the head down because it's possibly quite far of the other side there. Let's go and check out that two track just in case. Yeah, it's only one or two females now that's got the head. I don't think we're going to catch this. Again, he was a bit on a mission. Oh, there he is. Okay, let's go and have a quick look down here and if there's another one. Come back to him. If there's something walking along this road, because it's quite low down, so we may not be able to have seen it from the other side. It may just give us a different perspective. Impala give an alarm call, they're usually pretty accurate. Sometimes they can be mistaken. I've seen Impala alarm call for baboons before, and warthogs. And although baboons, male baboons can eat baby Impala, they don't necessarily see them as a threat. So you don't really get them alarm calling because they're a possible threat. I think it's just a case of mistaken identity. Could have been the same here, but it's worth just checking out. Thinking, if they didn't come and check it out, what if? If anybody would like to ask any questions on this see, there's still a lot more fruits in the trees. So we should still hopefully get to see a lot more elephants on this open area. It's quite funny, once the fruits have all been eaten off the floor, the elephants will start to use their heads and the trunks to try and shake down any more fruits from the trees. I've just spied who's making the call, the woodland kingfisher, and he's sitting on a branch just to our right, so we might be able to have a quick look at him. Busy preening at the moment. These are the birds that you're hearing calling out. Chip-chirr! The bright turquoise blue and the red bill. A very distinctive bird in colour, but also in sound. Possibly communicating with its partner. No, apparently not. The bull elephant has moved on. There he goes. So I think we'll do the same. Karula last being seen on Triple M again. Apparently she was seen yesterday, I think, by Hendry. I think we'll go and have a look on the western side. We'll just move past this bush here. Slightly closer than what we were. You might be able to hear the soft chirping of the foot-tailed drongo. This is quite a good opportunity to see how big those eyes are. They're actually not very big compared to the size of his head and compared to the size of his ears. The eyesight is quite poor. We're actually looking into the bush. They've got very, very close eyesight. So if they are, they can see what they're eating. You may even notice the long eyelashes on those eyes to help protect them, especially when they do put their heads into a branch, or even when they're tearing down a branch, it might just help with any splinters that may fly. Throwing soil on his back to try and chase away the insects. Just making use of those ears to do the same thing. It's not overly hot here at the moment. It's still quite a nice pleasant temperature, although he will be creating a lot of heat within his body, and that's how they do help to cool the bodies down. That's their radiator. Give off the heat that's produced from the body. And by flapping their ears, they just send a little bit of air over them to assist with that.
I'm going to go to my own.
get the little Fort Todd Drongos in the tree? Do you think you'd be able to get the Fort Todd Drongos just to turn a little branch of this? I don't know if I'm in the right spot. It's been a while since we've actually seen the Fort Todd Drongos properly. Yeah, it's that little branch that's curling over us. One sitting there. More closer towards the... A beautiful deep pool. Sorry, Mr. Are we in your way now? You see, they have little hairs on the bottom of the chimney. And also, help just to feel where the trunk is and where the food is reaching the mouth. Using the two fingers of the trunk to pick up the mealybugs. You can see how he's doing that now quite nicely. You can see him just moving his trunk along. He's pretty accurate if he was. Every time he puts his trunk down, he's not a million miles away from where the fruits are. Thank you. Now, where he's got his foot bent at the moment, that's the equivalent of our fingers. And what we class as the knee is actually the wrist or the ankle. They have the same bones that we have in our fingers and in our arms, just one more elongated. So what you would class as the wrist is where the finger equivalent of ours is. That's where he was just bending his foot then. Mm-hmm. You sure leave me in peace. Considering he was on a mission this morning. Quite amazing how close he actually came to us in the end. Good morning to you, Phyllis. And just asking, if their eyesight is so poor, how do they locate their food and how do they tell the foods apart? The smell definitely plays a very important role in that. And as we saw earlier, he was lifting his trunk up and he was actually smelling to see where the marula fruits were. And I think that's why he was on a bit of a mission this morning to get to those trees where there's still marula fruits around. As I say, they do have eyesight. It's not as if they don't have any eyesight at all. And they will be able to see what they're eating from the bushes. But certainly you can see he's using his trunk more to locate the fruit on the floor rather than having to push his head forward and have a look on the ground. I mean, from where he's standing, you'll probably be able to see the fruits to his right. But certainly through the grass, he's not really going to be able to see them too well. He's using his trunk just to search through the grass to find those fruits. So smell is definitely very important to an elephant in locating food. And in locating other elephants, the hearing is extremely important. Good day to you, mister. Interesting question. How do the elephants have a long tongue and do they use it to pant like a dog? And the second part of that question is that they use their ears to pant in a way. They don't pant, they don't really have the same setup to help cool them off as a dog does. So the way they cool down is using their ears. and they have a lot of blood vessels in their ears, and about 20 liters of blood is cycled every minute through those ears, and it can take maybe about 20 minutes or so for all the blood in their body to be cycled through the ears. And as they flap their ears, that blood has the airflow over it, and that helps to cool them down. And it can shed about 3 degrees of heat, which is quite a lot for an animal that size. Can actually produce quite a lot of heat. So being able to get rid of that 3 degrees or so just by flapping their ears can help keep them cool. And that's their equivalent of a dog panting. Tongue size. There is some movement of the tongue. I don't know if you've ever seen, if you've gone to the zoo and they've actually shown you how they do a medical check, that's usually what they show you. If you go to a zoo, they have the elephants there and they get the elephants to open up the mouth a little bit, and the people can put their hands in to feed, and the mouths don't open that wide. The mouths maybe open about this sort of width. They do have quite a large tongue, but again they can't poke it out like we can. Lengthwise, I'm not entirely sure. I think a guess, just judging by the size of their heads, my guess would probably be about the length of my arm here, from my elbow to my hand, but I've never actually looked properly at the tongue of an elephant. They won't be able to stick the tongue out as far as what we could or a dog could. But again, they don't need to, because their trunk does all the work for them. As you were seeing with the marula fruits that the elephant was picking up, he could pick up the fruits and throw them into his mouth, place them into his mouth. Depends on the individual. We have seen them doing both ways. So there's not really any need for them to be able to stick the tongue out, and those hairs that I was pointing out a little bit earlier on the chin can help to guide the food and the branches into the mouth as well, using the trunk to put it into the mouth. Even water, they'll suck up a few liters of water, again depends on the size of the trunk. I've heard anywhere between 4 and 10 litres. I think 10 litres is probably a bit of an exaggeration. I've heard that being quoted before, maybe for a very large elephant. But I think the average is probably about 4 to 6 litres in the trunk. And they'll suck that up and squirt it into the mouth. So think about a dog. The dog has to lap the water up. An interesting question from you there, Laurie. Thank you. Maybe someone can look up the length of tongue on Wikipedia or something for us. See if it will give the size of the tongue. Oh, it's Mr. Dwarf Mongoose. an African civet walking down here. I'm just going to check out Impala Plains quickly. You never know. There must be a lot of animals around here. The lions and Karula has been using this area a lot recently. The last thing we heard from Karula was that she was on Triple M last night, or yesterday morning. I think it was yesterday morning, and she looked like she was heading west into Zimbabwe again. But I'm sure she would have moved the Kurds before the lions got to that area. That was the last time that we actually saw her, and the lions, we left them sleeping exactly where we lost her 2 days before that. It's quite amazing. Quiet here on Impala Plains. Maybe that's because the cats have been through here and everybody decided to disperse. Thank you. passionate with us. And that's work harder. Work harder, bird. And on the weekends, drink lager. Oh, I missed somebody's tracks here. Wildebeest tracks. And baboon tracks. The looks of it. Thanks, Denise. I got the tongue weighs about 12, was that 12 kilograms? And the tongue is quite long and thin. I didn't get a measurement. I don't know if there was a measurement there. Oh, no measurement. Thanks, Denise. So the tongue is quite a heavy muscle, about 12. Kilograms, which is actually 12 kilograms, is about the same size as a giraffe heart. It's long and thin. So if anyone can get a length for us, that would be awesome. Thanks for the weight, Denise. Appreciate it. It's quite amazing. I have to remember that it's about the same size as a giraffe heart. Although the elephant weighs a lot more than a giraffe. Who said that, but apparently there's no recorded length for a tongue yet. It's kind of interesting. Oh, Yvonne. Thanks, Yvonne. No recorded length for a tongue yet. Very true, John. The size of the elephant's tongue will depend on the size of the elephant. That is always very true. And whenever we do give, I mean, like the tongue of an elephant, the weight, is usually based on an average. Average-sized animal or... Sometimes they'll be given for the largest animal recorded. So any values that you are given, say tusk can weigh or a trunk can weigh, or all these measurements, you always need to take with a pinch of salt, because obviously a baby is not going to be weighing in or measuring in at that length or weight. And you can get some small individuals, you can get some large individuals. So whenever we give a value, it generally is for an average-sized animal. Unless stated otherwise. A very good point there, John. everybody else also looking up the weight and the length. I think Laurie also came back with 12 kilograms for the weight of the elephant's tongue. And I missed two elves. Thanks, guys. It's always great to get some feedback. Big family of magpie shrikes. Used to be called long-tailed shrikes. But as you can see, they have a long tail. I think these are the chicks that we were hearing in a tree along this road, actually, a little while ago. Now, males tend to get much longer tails than that. Females are only slightly longer, so I think these are the juveniles. And there's quite a lot of them. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 in this family that I can count. The magpie shrikes are a cooperative breeder. I thought I was getting trapped in spider web. Somebody is building, is trying to build a web here on Dunder. And it looks like they're going to use the same nest. They were nesting in this tree in front of us. This is the Tamborta tree. I just saw them all fly back there. I remember driving past here one day and hearing the chicks. And I think that is the chicks. The parents will allow the offspring from one generation to stay, and they'll help to rear the next generation of offspring. Increases the chance of survival because there's more mouths to go and find food and bring food back to the chicks. That's why you can get groups of birds all together, and the magpie shrikes is one of them. As far as I know, the only shrike to do that. Well, the only shrike here in South Africa, should I say. See, the southern white crown shrike also is a cooperative breeder, thinking about it. So I've just proved myself wrong. There you go. Zebra tracks! So the zebra might be up here. But no Karuda tracks at the moment. And rhino tracks. Oh, there's been a lot of animal movement. And rhino toilet. I wonder if we're going to be lucky enough to see the rhino. I think maybe a trip down towards Treehouse Dam might be in order before we head off towards the east. Haven't heard anything about the Lions. Hexham was following up that side. Good morning, lady. Female kudu, unusual for her to be on her own. Maybe the rest of her family are further into the bush, we just can't see them. See how well those disruptive markings work. Rhino came back out onto the road here. Though it wasn't recently, there's a lot of traffic over the Rhino tracks. Sometime last night. I heard the movement, but I think it was just the tire scraping by some of the lower branches on the floor. Thank you. Ungo's got a bit shy. Oh, there you are. And maybe before we can get Ungo, there's a little village weaver. Oh, he's just flown off. There's a village weaver on the road. Trying to get my names mixed up. Indigo bird, not indigo weaver. Are you going to come and say hello to us, mister? Quite amazing to think that there was hippos even larger than this at some stage. Especially around Europe. In fact, there was hippos twice the size of hippos of today. And even more dwarf hippos around Madagascar and Cyprus. The pygmy hippo is not closely related to the Nile hippo that you see in front of you. They're in a different genus altogether. And it's rolling over. mind. I think our friend came from the south, he's probably his friend. Sitting on a bench there. Maybe at an awkward angle. Jacobin cuckoo. Looks like a juvenile, he hasn't got the bright white breast. Oh. Nice try. I'm sure the bird just sit there and think, right, I'm just going to wait until the camera points this way and then I'll fly off. They'll see us moving, they actually watch me. Cuckoo, watch me move. Watch Herman move. And just as the camera is pointing at it, it's going to decide to fly away. A Jacobin's cuckoo. That I started hearing the last couple of nights is the fiery-necked nightjar, so definitely listen out for that on the waterhole camera now. They've been calling the last couple of days. That's a nocturnal bird. Very vocal one. There's any chance of getting these tracks here. I do have some leopard tracks. Heading in the direction that we've just come from. Turn here and then maybe go back along Philemon's cook line. I didn't see any tracks that side though. Hmm. about these ones. It's still a little bit in a bad light. No, the big ones. The big ones. The deep ones. Yeah. Okay. I don't know if we're gonna be able to show it too nicely, but it's worth having a go. I want you guys to tell me which tracks you think they are. I'm gonna stand next to them.
Do you see these ones here?
There's no way anyone's gonna identify them.
Okay.